Well, like, guys, welcome everybody. Like, to be like fully honest with you, I didn't expect that so many people would come to an Elixir meetup. So I was just looking at the counter, you know, like when you're a meetup organizer, you receive all the numbers of people that sign up. I was like, wow, this is going high. So I called Lunatech, hey, we need to increase the pizza. Okay. And then it goes up and up and up and up. I was like, oh, guys, we need a lot of pizza. So yeah, really, really happy that you guys are here. It took me a long time, to be honest, to organize this meetup. And so I'm really happy that Arjen tonight is going to talk to us about Elixir. This new, I mean, maybe not very, very new, but definitely on the grow up, on the ramp up as usage and adoption. So I'm personally super excited and super curious. And after the first introduction, we'll do this little workshop together. Just a very quick hands-on thing. We haven't really prepared much, or maybe almost at all, I would say. It's really just a last-minute community thing, so it's just to have fun together. And I'm sure it's going to be a lot of fun. So for those who are here for the first time, Reactive Amsterdam, we really are about everything React, which is a lot of reactive programming, but also the reactive system design. So, you know, this is the Reactive Manifesto written by Bonaire and other people a few years ago. And so those are really high principle, very high level, like architectural goals. You want your system to be resilient. You want to be able to scale up and down as needed. They don't imply any technology choice, except that weird trade down there, message driven. That is me really a bit closer to the implementation level. But so what we do at this meetup is we talk about a lot of different technology that sort of try and fit into this grand scheme of things. And also I need to say that this meetup tonight wouldn't be possible without the Lunatech guys. So please, a big applause. And can we look at the crowd one moment? Yes. Can we film the crowd? Crowd, be happy. Woo! All right, well, I think that's pretty much it for my introduction. There's only one last thing that I want to mention, and it's something that I started thinking about lately, which is a big topic in the tech world, and it's diversity. And so I'm just going to share with you my reasoning a little bit and my line of thoughts. You know, diversity in tech is a big thing. I mean, we are mostly males. Actually, tonight maybe we're only males, except for Celeste. So that's one thing. And also, well, I mean, we are in mostly white males, and I've been thinking about this a little bit, and I've been thinking about how we can try and make things a little more inclusive, or I don't know, really just sharing thoughts. Actually, if you have thoughts, please share it with me. Maybe add in a code of conduct that explicitly mentions, you know, inclusivity or things like that, or maybe mentoring young speakers. I don't know. The goal of this slide is this. If you also find it interesting to think about these things, reach out to me, and maybe we can test things together. We can, I don't know, think about it together. Because of course I'm alone, and if I think about it alone, it's not as powerful as thinking, you know, with you guys. So well, message for this slide: if you want to get involved a little bit, have suggestions, please get in touch with me. And that's really all from me. So enjoy tonight. I'm very happy that we're all here. Thanks.
Thank you for inviting me, and it took indeed a long time to set this meeting up. I think like at least half a year. In the same time, I actually organized also this conference. But I'm really happy to be here, and I always enjoy speaking for well, a diverse audience in the sense that they do other languages than just Elixir. Because I'm a regular speaker at the Amsterdam Elixir meetup. That if you are not a member yet, you should check it out. So, tonight I'm going to tell you my view or what I think of how Elixir and Erlang are reactive systems. But first, a little bit about myself. I'm from Amsterdam, and I have a master's in artificial intelligence, but it's already a long time ago, and after that I actually did not do anything with it, so I decided to go to art school. So I did the Rietveld Academie, and then after that I tried to combine like art and technology as a freelancer. So I worked a lot with artists and museums and all kinds of different companies in the public sector to do interesting things. And actually, while I was freelancing, I also got in touch with Erlang, and it was almost 10 years ago already. A friend of mine was doing PHP, but he was really frustrated. He built a whole framework and CMS in PHP, as you do when you write PHP. And he found it really frustrating that it really limited, like the performance was pretty bad, and there was a lot of things that weren't good enough. So he took a year off to do some research, and he stumbled upon Erlang. Turned out to be a great fit for his needs, which was just a web server that can do a lot of things concurrently. So then he thought, hey, I know Arjan, I'll introduce him to him. To Erlang, so he did, and I really liked it, and that's actually also strange because Erlang is not really a language that you like very quickly because the syntax is pretty weird. It looks a lot like Prolog, but that's actually the reason why I liked it, because I studied AI, and AI, well, Prolog is like a logic AI programming language. Anyway, long story short. So when Elixir first came around 2014, 13, something like that, first I thought I don't need this language because Elixir is really a language. It's basically, if you look it through your hairs of your eyes, you see Erlang, because Elixir and Erlang is basically the same thing. It's a bit of different syntactically flavored. But then I saw that the community around Elixir was growing and picking up pace because Elixir really is trying to make developers happy and really work for the developers to get all the hassle and the stuff that you need to do to get an Erlang system up and running out of the way. So I basically just switched to Elixir, sort of. And then since the 1 year, I've founded my own company, and we are building chatbots. That combines my Elixir love with my AI background, so that's also very nice. We built a platform on top of Elixir to help customers with their like support cases and sales kind of chatbots. So that's that. If you want to know more about that, we're not hiring actually. We're just three guys. But anyway, I really like to work on it, and keep an eye on us. So without further ado, what exactly is reactive programming? I didn't hear of this term very often yet, and that's maybe because I'm in a totally different programming world than the rest of other people. So I actually had to look it up and see what exactly is it. And hey, now my, oh, okay, that didn't work. So it's a declarative programming paradigm concerned with data streams, the propagation of change. Is it ReactiveX or is it React? When I tell people I'm doing something reactive programming, they say, oh, you do React? Yeah, I do React as well. React is not really reactive. And there's RxJS, and there's all different kind of libraries, and like, what the hell is it? And then I actually saw the reactive manifesto, and then I thought, oh, wait, so here is where it all came from. So you probably are, most of you are probably familiar with this manifesto. Like Fabio said, there are actually four main topics in there. Reactive Manifesto says that systems should always be responsive, they should be quickly to respond, they should act like everything is okay on the outside, and even if something's wrong, then they still should give you a happy or a quick response that, that saying that something wrong and it should not like do nothing. It should be resilient, so it should be tolerant to failures. It should be elastic in the sense that it can handle the demand, like, you know, the amount of visitors, it can scale up automatically or it can scale down when there's nothing to do. And as an implementation detail, let's make it message-driven, because message-driven is really the way how you make things resilient, I guess. But I'll come to that later. That's actually funny that you say that. That's really basically an implementation detail. I think the top three arguments are really, you know, these are the goals of the system, and the other one is basically like a solution. But still, for me, it's very good that it's there. The Reactive Manifesto, I think, starts like this. Organizations working in disparate domains are independently discovering patterns for building software that looks the same. So I think it was in 2011 that there was a press release somewhere that said, now we know where Erlang came from. Erlang copied Scala's actors, and Erlang's VM is almost a clone of the JVM. So this was a press release. I think this was released at the same time as the Erlang user conference was there. There was an interview with the Erlang founders, Robert Ferding and Joe Armstrong, and they sat down and they said, yeah, we have to admit this is really true. I couldn't find the video, unfortunately, but it was really funny. Well, it was on April Fool's, obviously. Just to say that I think the Reactive Manifesto takes a lot of the things that Erlang guys actually already know for a very long time, but they just don't talk about. That's also kind of their issue, that they don't have like the whole sales hype that they need to say, yeah, we are the best and the biggest, etc. They just do stuff and it works. You don't hear anybody about it. So let's do a brief history of Erlang and Elixir. So Erlang started, it's originated in actually 1986. Guy John Armstrong, Robert Ferding, and Mike Williams, they worked at the Ericsson Research Lab. And what they really wanted is to make something that's really stable. So they thought, why not build a system that's really good and we just use it for our phone switches, because our phone switches need to be, you know, if somebody is talking to another guy and something else is happening, it should never fail. The call should always go through. So it was a research project for a long time at Ericsson, and I think the big milestone they hit in 1998 was that Ericsson made this AXD301 phone switch, which had the famous 99 of uptime. So that means that it's basically, I think that's 10 milliseconds downtime in 4 years or something like that. So, and it ran on Erlang, and it ran on special hardware with directly Erlang on it. In the same year, actually Erlang was open sourced. And it was also, I think 1 year later or so, Ericsson actually decided to stop Erlang in favor of Java. And that was because of concerns that not enough people were using there was more weight behind Java, etc. So they decided we're going to do Java from now on. And actually, a few years later, they switched it around, and they're doing a lot of Erlang again now. I think they do a lot of things. But luckily they open sourced it around the same time. So actually, I think last week was the 20th birthday of the open source Erlang version. And then a few years later, Elixir 1.0 was released in 2014. Should I tell a bit more about Elixir? The difference between Erlang and Elixir, like I said, is mostly the mostly how it looks. Because there was José Valim, the founder of or the inventor, what you call it, of Elixir. He was in the Rails core team, so he was a developer on Rails working for an agency. And at some point he thought, a bit like my friend Mark had with PHP and Erlang, he had with Rails. He was really frustrated by the limitations of the Ruby interpreter that you couldn't do much concurrently, etc. So he was looking for something that could help him with that. So he switched to Erlang, and he saw the same, like Erlang is not really is not really developer friendly, or is actually very developer unfriendly. So he fiddled around, and at some point he came up with Elixir, which is basically Erlang but with a Ruby flavor. So it looks much like Ruby. So you see also a lot like the new Elixir developers, mostly they have a Ruby background because they also feel the need that Jose felt back then. So they need a web server with WebSockets. You know, and with Ruby it's really hard to do a web server with WebSockets. I don't really know. It's probably possible. But it's a lot harder, and that's because of the way the architecture of the Ruby interpreter versus the Erlang VM, the difference in those. Because in Elixir, I think this is already 4 years old. The Phoenix team, which is Phoenix, is the frame. It's like the Rails for Elixir. It's a web framework. Basically, they tried to let's see how many concurrent WebSockets we can do. And I think at some point they just stopped measuring. There was some artificial system limit here that says let's just drop the rest. But there was not a real limit in how many concurrent WebSockets you could have on one machine. I think their limit was that they ran out of money because they had to set up so many test machines to feed to benchmark that one server that at some point they stopped doing it. It's a pretty nice talk if you want to look it up. It's already a few years old, but still very relevant. There's other success stories as well, right? Like WhatsApp, I think they ran like 160 a user base of, I don't know how much, but like in the 160 millions or something users, and they had I think 10 or 15 developers or something like that. So every user was like responsible for, you know, every developer was responsible for like 10 million users, which is pretty ridiculous if you compare that to other companies like Facebook. So there's a lot of success stories, but at the same time, of course, we can always grow. So how does all of this work internally? Like I said, you have multiple flavors. The architecture is a bit the same as the JVM with Clojure and Scala and Java. So you have your source file, and the source file is compiled into bytecode, and the bytecode is executed by a virtual machine. By the way, if any of you have questions, or if I'm going too quickly or too slow, please just raise your hand and if anything is unclear. So this is basically how it works. So Erlang and Elixir are totally interchangeable, like with Scala and Java. It works the same. You can call Elixir from Erlang and Erlang from Elixir. It gets compiled and then it gets run. And the Beam VM it can be really compared to the JVM, but of the internals are very different, as we will see. So just to give you an idea of how it looks, this is Erlang code actually. I just took some random Erlang code and put it up here. So it's very functional. Everything is a function. So this function, this is actually the same function, but this is like a polymorphic function. And variables are with capitals, and functions are with lowercase. So people have quite a hard time sometimes to wrap their head around this. Whereas with Elixir, it already looks a bit more like object-oriented or like traditional. Especially Ruby people really like that in Elixir you have to brace everything with do and end. So you should probably do curly braces here to please the Java people. So it's a bit more verbose, but at the same time, it's also very readable. And actually, Elixir adds some nice constructs to the language, like the pipe operator, which I will also look into a bit more later. But let's first go over the design principles to come back to the Reactive Manifesto. The only design principle of the Beam is that it should be a fault-tolerant system. So no matter what happens, the main principle of the Beam is that it should not crash no matter what stuff you are doing in your code. And actually, as a side effect of that, or as a a result of that, they decided to do it in a functional language, because in a functional language, well, there's immutable state, so you cannot really copy state, so you don't have multiple writers to the same variable to create deadlocks or race conditions. The other thing that they found, that it was very concurrent, because they decided to use the actor model to handle this resiliency property principle. And that turned out to be a very good way to do things concurrently. So some people think that Erlang is really a thing that, right, you can do things concurrently very easy, but it's actually just a side effect of it being so fault tolerant. So let it crash is really the mantra in the Erlang world, and no matter what happens, if you have a phone call with somebody else and somewhere else something crashes or runs out of memory, whatever, our interaction should not be affected by the world burning down somewhere else. Like I said, with functional programming, with Elixir, it's really, there are no objects. It's just a function, so it's just, the functions are namespaced in a module, so you have a module and the module has functions, and if you want to call another function, you just say module.function, and then you call another function. But you have to give every variable to the other function. There's no this or self. You pass everything and everything is returned to you. So. That's how functional programming mostly works. So you're constantly creating new data based on the old data. And actually, it's not such a functional language as pure as, for instance, Haskell, where it's really hard to do any side effects, for instance, write to the database or write to the screen. With Haskell, you really have to declare all of that to be very very explicitly. But with Erlang and Elixir, it's a bit of more like a pragmatic approach to functional programming language, where you can also just write stuff to the database, but then at the same time still keep the, if you want to make, keep functions pure, it's also possible to do that. And I think well, there's actually a whole lot to tell about functional programming, but the one that I want to pick out is pattern matching. And how many of you do Scala here? Oh, that's a lot. So you probably know pattern matching a bit. But I think you have like this special, there's something special, right? You cannot do it everywhere. You can only do it in let and matchser. Wherever you see this sign, this assignment operator, it's actually not an assignment operator, but it's the pattern match operator. And it's actually also used in different places. So whenever you say A equals 1 or assign 1 to A, what it does, it tries to it's like a balance, like with math, right? If X equals 1, what should X be? Well, 1, because 1 is the same. So it tries to get the value on the right side and put it, match it as much as possible to the values on the left side. And it does so by putting stuff into variables, because they are unassigned, so there are free slots to put stuff into. But you can also have more complicated matching expressions. You can actually have very, very complicated matching expressions. So this one is also valid. So it tries to match, on this side there's a list, on this side there's a list as well. So then it runs through the list and it sees, okay, so X is going to be 1, right? And then 2, well, 2 is 2, so that's already done. If I would have put 3 here, then it would have crashed, because it's... it cannot match it. It can, those things never fit. You cannot fit it like a square peg into a round hole, right? So that's a bit how it works. And that's also how you do things like polymorphism in Elixir. So as you saw earlier, you can have functions, but you can define them multiple times with like the same number of arguments, just with different pattern matching constructs in the function. And it's also used a lot for things like assertion. So what you see with Elixir is that you really just program the happy path. And it's also like the let it crash principle, something that is, you know, unexpected. We just let ourselves crash. And that means, you know, that we are probably going to be restarted by our supervisor or something like that. So here the user validators function is called. And we assert, like with this assignment, we assert that it returns an OK tuple. So this is, a tuple is like a fixed list of values. And it this is like one of the common things in Erlang or in Elixir that you do when you want to assert that something is true, then you say, well, this, if this returns error or whatever, then this doesn't match, so it will actually just blow up. So we know that the code below here is very safe, so we really know that this has worked. Talking about processes, so the actor model, I don't know if it was invented by the Erlang guys, but it's the main feature actually of the Beam VM, which is the virtual machine. So this is, for those who don't know, this is a bit how actors work. You can see actors as like very lightweight threads. They're not real threads, they're also not real like Unix processes, because when we say these are actors are processes in Elixir world, or you could just call them actors. But they're very lightweight. You can literally spawn millions of processes just on one machine. If they don't have anything to do, they don't get scheduled, so they don't take up any resources except for a bit of overhead, like, you know, 8 kilobytes or 4 kilobytes per process or something. So that's not a lot. So in this system, we have four actors, and the actors, they can communicate each other only via message passing. So it's a bit like talking to somebody in the real world. If you talk to somebody, you know, you send messages, and then he processes it in his head, and, you know, so he has his message queue so this is the only way. You cannot see into somebody's head, right? There's no telepathy. So this is also how the actor model works. You cannot see inside an actor's own state. You can only try to get his state by sending a message, and then he sends a message back. So in that sense, every actor is like its own little thread that has its own little state, like just variables with stuff in it that he needs for something, you know, to remember. And he can communicate with other actors, processes, by sending messages. And if he wants a message back, he actually has to send his own address with him, because send is just asynchronous. You send something to him, and then it probably will arrive, but it also might not arrive. And that's actually also a very important thing, because if you make that assumption, or if you, how do you call that? Well, if you want to build like a message that's also being acknowledged by the other party, then you have to build that yourself on top of this. But these are the basic primitives. I think even in the reactive manifesto, there's something about like asynchronous message passing. So these are the three principles that are, I think, the most important like part of the Erlang, which are, well, send, receive, and spawn. And send, like I said, is just fire, forget, send a message to another bit, process identifier. Receive is a construct that blocks. So if you do receive, then it actually just waits for a message to arrive in the mailbox. And with spawn, you spawn another process. So that makes, you give it a function or a reference to a function, and that function executes, you know, in a different context. So is this readable? Sort of. I give an Elixir bootcamp, when people to get acquainted with processes, we do an example like this. So this is a key value store module. It's basically just, you could see that's like a little service that remembers stuff for you, like a Redis or whatever. So you can start it and start actually. So there's a few functions called start. Start returns a process identifier. Put, delete, wipe. So some things that you can do with a key value store. And then these functions just send, because the pit is actually the name of our key value store. So this sends the message put to the key value store, etc. And then on the other side, when init is called, init calls, this is run in a different process, right? This is the server, or, you know, the store process. So this calls loop. And loop, basically all it does, it gets some values, which is like its own state, and it does a receive. So it just does nothing, just waits there, it sits there until it gets a message. So here you see a message or a pattern matching in action. So it does receive, And then if it receives a pattern like this, which is our internal protocol, because this is being sent here, then it puts that key that it gets with the value under that key into its own array, and it calls itself again. So it recurses, so just that it stores the message, or it stores the value, and it recurs. So that's basically it. So it gets a message to store something, and then it does that. And with delete, the same. So it deletes values from its own internal dictionary, and then it calls loop again. For those who don't know, there's whenever the recursion function is called, that's the same as the function it's called from, and it's the last one in the function. Then it actually doesn't put a frame on the stack, but it just replaces the stack frame with the new stack frame. So that way it can do infinite loops. It's actually the only way, otherwise you would get a memory leak. Well, loop is called, right? We call spawn here, spawns a new process that calls loop here, right? And then loop is being called with like an empty thing, and then the process just blocks here. So as soon as you send something to it, then it wakes up and it sees, hey, is it in my inbox? Does it match? And the first message in my inbox, does it match any of these clauses? How it actually internally works, I don't really know, because I don't have to read a lot of C code probably. There's probably like different EVM instructions for that. And then as soon as the message matches one of these things, then it will execute that code. In this last example, actually, when we do a get, it actually you want a value from the store, right? So you send something here, and then actually it sends its own process identifier with it, so that it can send something back. Yeah, so this receive is the same, but here there's no pattern match at all, because this is just, it receives anything and will use that as the return value of this get function, which of course can be dangerous. So code like this you almost never see in real Erlang projects, especially like these receive loops. There is higher level constructs to deal with that, because this, if you need to write a lot of like gen servers or services processes to do stuff, you need to write a lot of boilerplate. So that's why you barely see the send, receive, and spawn functions being used in practice in any like production system. Well, you can do it, but you can also use things that are more on a higher level. And that's actually where the OTP part come in. When you hear like Erlang OTP is used as one phrase usually, and OTP stands for Open Telecommunications Platform, and it's basically a set of libraries and guidelines that build on top these primitives, the BeamVM, to build like the building blocks where you can build your application with. In a system, everything you do is a process. When you build a web server, your incoming request is a process. It just lives for 10 microseconds and then dies again when it has sent a response. Everything. So there are short-lived processes, but also long-lived processes for WebSocket connections, etc. Database pools. Everything that you do in Erlang is in a process. Also, if you are in the shell, in a shell terminal doing something, that's also just a process. And actually, most of the processes, like I say, the higher level building block on top of that is called GenServe. And a GenServer, you could see it as like a little microservice, like the key value store that we built here. It has like an interface, it has like its own internal state, and you can send messages to it, and they can be either like fire and forget, but some messages you also want an answer back. So that's called GenServer cast and GenServer call. So you build your application out of these gen servers that you build together, and you send messages between them. You have different gen servers for all kinds of things. You also want to be sure that when something crashes, then this server needs to be restarted properly, right? For instance, if your database goes down, you probably want your connection pool to retry, and that the process just restarts and keeps retrying. So the gen servers, it's not the gen server's responsibility to deal with that, and that's the supervisor. So there's a layer on top of it a special process that monitors the behavior of its child processes. I didn't explain that, but it does it by using links. So that's also a Beam VM primitive. So you can monitor or link to a process, and by monitoring a process, you get notified when he dies, basically. So whenever he dies, for some reason, he just says, "Oh, I'm gone," and then you get a message that say, "Okay, so this guy is now gone, and this was the reason why he was gone," and then you can do something about that. So that's how an OTP supervisor is implemented. It has its own children that it manages in some way, and then whenever they crash or something goes wrong, it has a strategy for restarting them. So this is how you build like your supervision tree, because these supervisors themselves can also crash, right? Maybe some cases they cannot really handle and they just decide, okay, well, I give up myself as well. Processes can also be restarted. On top of that, there's something that's called application process that is not really used for anything except for just some administration. And then all of this is wrapped inside an application. So an application in Erlang OTP and in Elixir is just one process tree with managed processes. In an OTP system, there's not one application, but there are several different applications running at the same time. So those applications, one of them or a few of them are probably your user code, but there's also applications that deal with SSL, application deals with, you know, web server. All your dependencies are probably also, they also have their own, you know, database drivers, connection pools for whatever. There are like tons of different things, and they all are contained in their own little or their own application, so they are totally separate from each other.
Yeah.
I did not tell you about that. Actually, there's a hot code reloading, so you can like make a new release with new versions of some applications, and you can put it on the server, and you can actually hot reload everything, or just the things that changed. That's actually how they achieve, of course, those 99s, because you cannot just restart the server, right? And you're then you're out. Who recognized this picture? I'm very good at drawing one thing for my daughter, Peppa Pig. as a demonstration application, I usually, a long time ago, I made this, let's call up the version here. Yeah, so it's a drawing application. I think I built it in, I don't know, 3 hours, like 2 years ago. And it's multi-user. So if you have multiple users here, then you can just draw stuff together. And this is, so it's collaboration, yeah, exactly. So this is, and it's pretty real time. This goes over the internet to Germany or something and back. So here you can create a new board, now create another board, la 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 la, etc. So we have these images here. I actually wanted to make a more fancy demo, but it's already pretty fun. And I wanted to show a bit to you like how this works on the inside. And of course we can do this with all together and draw like crazy, but that's a workshop later, yeah, just make drawings. But actually, I think it's nice because you are, I think, very interested in like the VM internals to see how something like this is implemented. Let's do it on localhost. So this will also demonstrate that. But there's actually multiple processes involved. So well, this works over WebSockets, obviously. So every time. I can first show, let's show it like top down. That's maybe the nicest. I should make my inspector probably a bit bigger. Is it this one? No, it's this one probably. So we have joined. So there's just some messages going over. And every time I move the mouse, you know, it sends like a shitload of messages. It's over WebSockets, yeah. So those are, actually does a lot of snapshotting as well. So it just sends like a very optimized JSON message. Cord. and it sends it to this. Well, I'm not going to explain how Phoenix works, but Phoenix has the concepts of channels, and channels are like this pub-sub hubs where you can connect your WebSocket to a channel, and the channel can like broadcast to everybody else in the same channel. Actually, also works like if you have a cluster of machines. So here it broadcasts to like the board 01, which is like this board that we just created. So every WebSocket is its, you know, in its own process, but actually the board, every drawing board also has its own process, and that process is just, well, it stores a couple of things. For instance, it's well, let's first show the supervision tree. I can also show it here. And I'm wondering if my screen recording still works. This is too small, right? Okay. You can see it. Okay, so this is the observer. An observer is like the, well, there's probably, I don't know what the Java tool for it does, but there's probably lots of tools for the JVM as well. So this shows, well, it has an insight into your running system. So it, for instance, it has like this top view where it just gives you a list of all the processes that are in the system, like the Unix top command, a bit like that. And it also has an overview of the applications, like I already explained, like that all these different applications are running here. So for instance, Cowboy is an application which is the web server. This is like IEX, which is like the interactive Elixir shell, because I'm running it now locally. And then actually, this one is my application code, Scribble. And Scribble supervisor tree looks a bit like this. So this process here, up here, is the most interesting. It's called board zero. So you can give processes a name. So then if you know the name of the process, you can send a message to it. It's very handy. So here we just have one board. But if we would start another board, we obviously would get more processes. Look. So there are now four boards. And you can even inspect these. So you can go into the process and see everything that's going on. So you can see the message queue, which will probably always be empty because it doesn't update so fast. And you can see the stack trace, so where it is right now, what it's doing. Well, it's not doing anything, it's just waiting in that loop function. And there's its internal state, so you can see like the internals, what is its internal state. And this is all free. This comes by default. Yeah, Observer it's called. And there's actually also a web version of that. So on this live machine here, on the really weird URL, there's the WOP server. And the WOP server is like the web version of the Observer that somebody made. So here, this is very insecure, of course, but it's just a toy application. I could crash it here, but here you see basically the same information. So you see the supervisor tree, you see the boards, etc. What else is there? There's the endpoint server, so that's the actual web server. So that pre-spawns 10 processes for accepting requests. By default, it does 100, but I reduced to 10 because the graph would be very ugly with 100. there's some other stuff. That's not really important right now. But the nice thing is that you can do a lot here. So you can you see that also it saves a preview image, so it saves like a base64 encoded image of the canvas to the server itself. I think this is the board, right? Board zero. If you kill it, nothing happened, it's still here. But if you look here, then it's empty. Because, well, it doesn't remember. We didn't save like our internal state or to the database or whatever. It just, when it's killed, you don't get any chance to recover out of the box. You just get started again with the initial values, and that is done by design to make sure that you don't immediately end up in the same failed state again, right? So this is, you just get started with a clean slate, and if you want to load something, you know, from persistent, you do that inside like your initialization. The WebSocket process, I think It is one of these projects, process, I think this one. So we can check that. So if we do, if we kill it, well, let's see. Let's go here. Console or whatever network. See if we kill it, then it should. I'm not sure if it is this one. Yeah. Did you see? Yeah. So it says, so it kills and then immediately restarts it again. Yeah, so all those processes are in here. Let me get back to my... no, wait, yeah, well, you didn't see anything how the game server, the board actually inside looks. But you can imagine that it's a bit the same as the key value store, only a bit more complicated. Let me actually show it. But yeah, it's not the most not the most pretty code. What? This is not the right one. Sorry. Oh yeah, it is. Oh, this is really weird. So its interface has some functions like, you know, get the state, like get the drawing, metadata, I don't know what it is, and set an image so that it like saves a snapshot of the image from the client to the server so that we can make the thumbnails. And then there are the most important functions are new line and add to line. A new line is when you click, when you press the mouse button, it calls new line. So then it starts a new line, and every time you do add to line, it just, when you move the mouse, it does the add to line function. We can actually, that's actually also nice. Well, that's gonna be gonna come, be, will become a bit messy. Well, you can try it. It's a live demo. What can go wrong? let's see. No. Wait. Debug trace. Oh, wait, this is different. Yeah, the syntax I always forget. Something like this. Yeah, okay. So now you see, with, you can really trace every message that goes in and out of this gen server. So now, well, this is what happens. And when you start a new line and you draw a little bit, well then, I can actually do it like this. So you see that big blob, that's the base 64 thing that every second I think it saves a snapshot. So the lines are getting bigger and bigger, so this is like a memory leak. Yeah, but in practice, yeah, of course you probably would do things differently, but I think this really, you know, when usually when people demo or demo Phoenix, they say, oh, you can make a web chat with it, you know, say send, hello, but this is way nicer because it sends so many messages that you would normally probably never do. Anyway, so back to the reactive manifesto. So now that you have looked a bit into how the beam works on the inside, I think that that it checks most of these boxes, and of course, going from bottom to top, the message driven is obviously, inspired by that. The resilient part is also very obvious because that's the main design goal of Erlang and Elixir. Elastic is, that's of course you, well, that does not come out of the box. It does not do like automatically scaling. You have to write that yourself. But as you have seen, it comes with a lot of tools to do introspection, like, you know, how busy are my systems, etc. And you can use that information, for instance, to say to Kubernetes to spawn another pod or whatever. So you can use those metrics from inside the beam to do the Elastic part of that. Or inside your beam as well, if you need like more processes to handle something, you can also do it on that level. But you can also use it to scale up a whole cluster. And responsive, I think that actually comes from the fact that it's a resilient system. It can handle errors, so it will probably also always stay responsive. Includes, actually, I came, when I started to write this, I came upon this reactive streams, how many people use reactive streams kind of things? Also a lot of people. because that's actually why I was a bit confused about, like, what is a reactive thing? Is it streams, or should I just talk about streams, or should I talk about Elixir as in a general? What I want to do next is a bit like to tell you a bit how Elixir deals with like streaming data and how it can handle how that works. This Reactive Streams website has this whole like problem statement that we have to limit the resource consumption of systems, and it needs to be asynchronous, etc. And back pressure is very important. In some systems you have to jump through a lot of hoops to get that done, right? Because like with systems that are cooperatively multitasked, you really have to yield. So if you do something very busy on one thread, you cannot do anything else in the rest of your system. So a lot of these problems that are described here are actually not really applicable to Erlang and Elixir because they just don't exist. Also, things like race conditions or deadlocks you can get into situations where you have them, but you have to try a lot harder to do that. So Jose Valim, that guy over there, the creator of Elixir, gave a great talk almost 2 years ago about GenStage and Flow, which are like the building blocks for how to do like reactive streams in Elixir. And it starts with the pipe operator. So with the pipe operator, it's a very neat way to model in your code that something happens, and then that it's like the Unix pipe operator, right? It flows into the next one. Does Scala have one as well? No? You should add it. You already have a lot of operators, so this is one extra. so it looks a bit like this. So you read some text. By default, it reads line by line. And you pipe that, you pipe the whole contents of the text file into the split function. So then you split it, and then you have, or this actually doesn't read line by line, this reads actually just the whole file, it's just in one string. Then you pipe that to the next function to split it, and then you do that list of strings, you split again, on the space, that's the default argument of split. Flatmaps make sure that it's still one list and not like a nested list. You use that list of words, because now basically you created a list of words from that file, and you use that to update a map with the word count. So this is like a way to like count the occurrences of words in a text file. And the stream operator is really, well, you can also write it without the stream operator, but that would basically mean that you would have a lot of nesting of functions, and then you actually need to read the code from inside out, right? Because the inside is what gets executed first, so you read basically from right to left instead of like from top to bottom. But of course, yeah, if you do this, if your small.txt is not so small, but you know, like a few gigabytes big, then this is going to take up a lot of memory. And it actually will, it will probably be pretty fast, because you have a fast hard disk. If your data still fits into your memory, you probably won't have a problem. But you have this spike where, you know, you take up like a few gigabytes of memory because those words get copied, get split, so the new strings, so they take up like probably twice or three or four times the size of your original file. To counter that, in Elixir you have something that's called stream. And the stream is a lazy operator, so that builds a recipe of how you can process data. And the way it does that, this is the recipe that you say, give me that file. Like by default, it returns it in lines, and then lazily it maps it through the split function to get the words, and then it uses the normal reduce function to update this map again. So this works the same way as the previous one, except that it doesn't load the whole file into memory, but it just works line by line, but still of course in a single thread, line by line it goes through the file. I have also a demo of this, but I'll just show the next one, because the issue with this is that, well, it's very nice. It's a bit slower actually than just reading everything at once, but it still it just uses one process, so it just uses one core at the same time. So it's not, it can be made faster. So should we make it faster? Of course. so that's why Jose Valim created this library called Flow, and Flow is, it's a bit the same as Stream. So you use it to create like a recipe of your execution flow. But instead of doing this in one process as just a chain of functions, it actually creates a strategy where it creates multiple processes, parallel processes, and then splits the data automatically in those processes to reduce it, etc. And then you can collect it back into a main function and then do something with it. So under the hood, this looks almost still the same as the earlier versions, but actually this under the hood creates more like a recipe of what should be done. So we're reading the file here, but this is not really important how it exactly works. But what you see here in this syntax is that it, here at this point it tells it from, okay, now we have a flow of things that's going, and now with the partition statement you say, okay, we split it into by default a number of cores, so a number like 8 processes or something, and then all of those processes do this reduction. No, they probably do this, right, in this example, because this needs to be done in one process, otherwise you have multiple things. Okay, now you can also see how you start Elixir. So this is my word counter project. If I do IEX, it means interactive Elixir, and then start mix, then it says add in use. That means that I already have it started somewhere. Oh, here it is. Wait, yeah. Okay. Let's also open the observer, because it's of course nice to see what the properties of those different strategies are. So I think the most nice one is this scheduler. So the small TXT file is 8-9 megabyte-ish. It contains a lot of words. I also have a big file, but it's a lot bigger. So I'm not gonna use that. But the small file for demo purposes works fine. So if I'm gonna start word counter the eager version, which is the first version, right? Just put everything in the and processes at once. You can see on the right side here what the scheduler is going to do. Is it already done? No. Okay, so this took how much time took it? I can actually do it like this. Just measure the time it takes. There we go again. So it takes like 5 seconds, I think it measures in microseconds. And you see here on this graph, you see that there's just each of these graphs is one scheduler. So there's just one scheduler active. And if we do the lazy version, and also what you also see, of course, very important, on this side here, you see the memory usage. You see it spike, right? Every time I call it, I see, it reads the whole file into memory. The file was only 8 megabytes, but it takes quite a lot of memory for such a small file. But then, of course, it garbage collects and everything is okay, but still. So if I do the, lazy version, right? Yeah. Well, you see the same CPU spike. You actually see that there are different, so it's not all scheduled on one scheduler, right? There's multiple scheduler, but they take over from each other basically at this point. You see that the memory is more or less constant. It doesn't spike into the 500s here. And how long does it take? This one took almost 6 seconds, so that's a bit longer than the other one. If I do the flow one, then, hey, it goes a bit quicker. So this is almost a third of the time. And what you see here in this graph is that, well, it's a bit black graph, but that it's actually all four schedulers are active at the same time. So under the hood, they're split into four processes, and those processes just do everything that they can to process this data. Of course, it's very nice. It's like a mini Spark, but what's also very nice is that it's just this code that does that and make it so. So that's also one of the goals for Elixir, is to make it really these pretty advanced topics, to make them pretty accessible, and they really think about how the API should look, etc. So these three types you have, and so under the hood it builds like a pipeline made out of processes, not gen servers but gen stage processes that process this pipeline. And so if these are processes, then it can spawn like these in parallel, and then the events, they are produced here and they are processed here and consumed at some point again. But what's really nice is that it also does back pressure. So it's actually what is built into the very core, is that the consumer starts always. They say, hey, give me the next items. I need more. And that way, these guys and the producer only start to do work when they get the message, when they need to do more work or get more items from somewhere. And that can actually be used on top of... at this producer level, if you interface with something like RabbitMQ or just a normal TCP stream, there's all kinds of flow control mechanisms there to deal with that. So then the messages, if you have like a stream if you listen on a socket in Erlang, if you don't do anything with those messages, your message queue of your process gets full very quickly, right? And then your process crashes. But in TCP, with control flow, there's actually you can actually rate limit it there as well. So that's, if you would connect like a TCP stream or a RabbitMQ or something like that to the producer, then it can already, that's already built in. So the back pressure propagates all the way from the consumer down to the, even above the producer kind of thing. Yeah, I think actually that was it. And I would like to thank you very much for this talk.